Croissant dough was made the day before with a pre-fermented or old dough added to it. It was kept in the cool room overnight at 4 degrees. This helps to increase the strength of the dough, which therefore provides us with better flavour and a better flakier pastry. Doing now is getting our block of butter, kindly brought to us by Mr. Noy, is that we want to make it a little bit more pliable to be able to laminate into our pastry. So we'll just run it through the dough break a little bit, just to make it a little bit more pliable.
So this is a method that I saw in Paris as part of the World Pastry, World Baking Cup. So it's a way of incorporating the butter into the dough. It's still a lock-in method, but we're actually going to make sure by doing it this way we get a nice even lock-in of the butter. What I've done is I've just marked where that's going to sit. I'm using a rolling pin.
This is awesome.
Oh, I love it. It's a covered line.
Just following those lines.
How much would you learn if you worked with it for weeks?
One of the major problems that we've had with the lock-in method in the past is that when we put the butter in, actually pull that over, we've got a double wad of pastry there, and then when you put it through the machine you end up with that much dough on either side that's got no butter. By doing it this way we've got the edges really thin. So once we get it to there we can just stretch it up a little bit further, press it together. It was a method the Japanese used, and I saw it and I thought, that's a very clever way of doing it.
Brett, was that at the Coupe du Monde, Boulangerie?
Yes.
And you were a judge there, right?
I was fortunate enough to go and judge, yes, which was a great experience.
Who won that competition?
Japan won it. So this method was from the number one team for bakery in the world. So
it's the only way to test new procedures, new products?
Yes. We are getting to test them under the most extreme circumstances. And if they'll work in that, then they'll work in production. Because you can't get any more extreme than the World Cup.
No, it is the best of the best in the world.
Yeah.
Some people don't realise the sacrifice you need to make as a competitor to put yourself in that arena. It is a very tough thing to do.
Yes. So what I'm doing now, this ultimately will have three half turns. So I'm just going to even this out now. So I'll actually bring that back. Cut that bit off there. That'll give me a nice straight edge there. So I'm actually going to give it two half turns straight up, then rest it, and then come back and give it its final turn.
And you're using French flour and French butter?
Yeah, this is French flour and French butter.
What's the difference between the flour, between Australian and French flour?
There's a number of differences. The main difference is that when you think about, initially, if you think about the things that are different between our two countries, the first thing that comes to mind is the difference in environment. So our temperatures here are very different. They tend to be dealing with a wetter climate, and when you grow wheat in wetter climates, you get a different wheat variety, because they'll always tend to match the variety to the climate. So it's a softer wheat.
weaker wheat in protein?
Generally, it's a lower protein wheat, but they don't tend to mind that so much. So that's had two turns now. So I've now wrapped that in plastic just to stop it from skidding.
Whenever making pastry products or dough products in a bakehouse, we always keep them covered with a piece of plastic or keep them in a dough tub. So what we've done today is we've placed it in plastic so that it can go back on a tray, and then we can place it back in the cool room. The plastic will help prevent skinning on the dough piece, and if we get that skinning, it'll start to affect our layering and also the quality of our product. And in this case, we'll place it in the cooler.
It's the middle of winter and the bakehouse is quite cold because we don't have the ovens running. So I've got the benefit of setting this up at what you would call room temperature, between that 21 and 23, 24 degrees. So I've got that set now so that it's got the humidity and it's got a little bit of warmth, but not too much, just so that it keeps the dough active but doesn't retard it from being cold. But what we've got here in this one is this one's actually set up as a fridge. So that at the moment, with us doing our lamination with our croissants and Danish, we can put it into refrigeration so that it's nice and cold.
We need to keep our dough cold during the lamination process. This prevents any yeast activity. And also because of the Aussie climate, just especially during the summer months, we don't want any of our butter to melt. If the butter starts to melt, it just affects our lamination and our layers within our dough. Our half hour's up now, we're ready to do our third and final turn. This third and final turn should give us our nice even layers of fat and dough, and they should be a lot finer than what they were when we first started this process. Once we finish this third and final turn, like the first stage, we need to put it straight back into the cool room to keep this dough cold. We don't want any activity during this lamination process. Just like in the first stage, we need to keep it cool to prevent that fat from leaching out or melting within the dough. Okay, our last half hour's gone by in our resting stages, so now we're ready to pin our dough piece out. Make sure that when you're pinning it out, you come down slowly because we don't want to destroy any of those layers. We've taken this dough piece down to about 4 mil thick. This will be ready now to cut out and make our croissants or our danishes. You can cut your croissants or danishes out at whatever size that you wish, depending on how big you want the final result. The ones here that we're cutting out are 8 centimetres wide by about 12 to 14 centimetres long. This allows us to be able to roll up our chocolate pieces with inside the dough. Righto, we've got our required dough shapes now. As you can see, we're starting to add our Calabo chocolate sticks to it. For some of them as well, we've also rolled some 15 gram marzipan logs, so we've got chocolate and marzipan, which is a good combination. Once evenly placed on a tray, we're going to put them back into the prover now, but we want warmth in our prover now to get our yeast activity. This is where we want our yeast to start to rise, ready to go into the oven. Righto, our croissants have had an hour in the prover, they're ready to go into the oven. So we give them a nice coating of egg wash. The egg wash will give it a nice shine after bake, but it also will help with that initial first 5 minutes in the oven. It allows for us to get a little bit more volume, stop that outside surface from drying out. Just be careful when you're brushing the croissants. You don't want any of the egg to run down the sides because that'll trap on the bottom and it'll start to burn and it makes them look unsightly. As you can see there, they're the nice tiny fine layers of fat and dough. That's what's going to give us that nice flaky crispy pastry. Okay, to identify our chocolate marzipan croissants, just put a few flaked almonds on the top and that'll let us know that the marzipan, which is made from almond and sugar, we know that they're the marzipan croissants. Now ready for baking.
What's happening inside the oven now is that you've got all those tiny little layers of fat dough. The fat is starting to melt
create steam, same as the moisture inside the dough creating steam. So that's what pushes that dough apart. Now the fat inside there, I know it sounds pretty gross, but this is what tastes really good, is that fat is now frying those layers of dough. Okay, that's what gives us that nice flakiness, that nice crunch, okay, to a good Danish or croissant dough. You need smell-o-vision.
That'd be acceptable in any World Cup.
You can see there of a good quality croissant. You'll be able to see the nice fine layers where they're nice and crispy. You can see the shine from the egg coat that we had on there. And just to finish them off, we've just dusted half of the croissant with some icing sugar, and that's the lamination there that you can see. When we cut it open, you should be able to see on the inside the nice lamination, the separation of the layers of the fat and dough, and that nice creamy texture, and the nice crispy crust on the outside.